Thank you very much for that very generous welcome, Patrick. I remember when I first, one of the first times I floated the idea of clearance and movement of people through coercive means on the land in an area or a region outside the Highlands, namely in the Scottish Lowlands. It was in the town of Dornoch in Sutherland. I was given what is now the University of the Highlands and Islands, then it was a slightly different type of the organisation, a few years ago. I was giving the UHI Millennium Institute annual lecture, and I posed the question, clearance, why were the Highlands different? And I remember vividly in the Cathedral at Dornoch, the extraordinary level of the pulpit. After the polite and courteous, you know, clapping, 3 minutes later I was still climbing to the very top of it. And ringing in my mind was the statement of the chairman, I think that Tom Devine is entering a lion's den today. How dare he even imply that clearance is not unique to our society of Gaeldom? How could it possibly exist anywhere else in Scotland? So that was quite a challenge, but of course the Gaels were impeccably courteous and it went off, how can I use the term, reasonably well. I'm hoping that this audience will be even more sympathetic. The title of the presentation is the relationship between the Lowland clearances and the movement to New Zealand from Scotland. But because the term clearances or clearance will never ever be forgotten as unrelated to Highland Scotland, I want to begin in a set of introductory remarks about the Highland clearances and then move on to the better known context or the context less better known that I want to explore for the majority of the lecture. What actually happened in Lowland Scotland and the fact that to a very large extent outside the academy, if you will, outside the world of scholarship, the remarkable story of social change and how it impacted on the vast majority of Scottish people who lived north and east of the Highland Line will, I hope, be of interest and intrigue to you. Of course, the Highland clearances are one of the very few subjects in Scottish history that every Scot knows about, and every Scot has their views on it. A number of years ago, a group of sample of fourth-year pupils were asked, why did so many Scots leave Scotland? 67% of those fourth-year people said, because of the Highland clearances. And the other aspect of it which is critical is that of all the great historical changes that have occurred in Scotland, with the possible exception of Jacobitism, the clearances have endowed us with a wealth of story, of myth, of tragic reckoning and remembering, and even more recently with works of the theatre, works of drama, which have etched a view, a popular view, about what happened in Highland Scotland between the mid-18th century and the mid-19th century, which I don't think can ever be eroded. It's indelible. But to begin with, therefore, I want to give you a sketch of the current academic understanding of what clearance in the Highlands meant. It really essentially means coercive or compulsory movement of people, usually, but not necessarily always, against their will. It can often result in recirculation of population on landed estates. It doesn't necessarily always have the consequence of emigration, whether forced or voluntary, but it can do. And every single act of clearance, and they occurred between the 1760s and the mid-1850s in terms of mass movement, virtually every single act of clearance, every micro story, has its own particular identity and the explaining, the manifesting, the range of diversity which went into the great destruction, if you like, of the ancient Highland life. I think you could say that we now think in terms of a model of two phases of removal. And of course the phrase clearance is actually quite modern. It only begins to be used, and it's used originally as clearing rather than clearance, in the 1850s and 1860s, when the clearances were becoming something of political controversy, not simply in Scotland but the UK. The usual term at the time was removal. So great removals occurred from about the 1760s through to the mid-1850s. Phase one of clearance lasted from about the middle decades of the 18th century in the Scottish Highlands up until the end of the Napoleonic Wars. And the vital thing to remember about this particular phase, ladies and gentlemen, is it was not expulsive. And in fact, if anything, the landed elites were very keen to retain the population. What happened instead was the coercive movement of tenant farmers, of crofters, of cotters from the interior glens to the coasts, especially in the area from Ardnamurchan in the south to Caergrath in the north, and including all the inner and outer Hebrides. And the aim was to lay down the interior lands for wintering for sheep and, to a more limited extent, cattle, whereas the now redundant or moved populations would also have an economic function. They would have an economic function on the coast in the manufacture of kelp, which is an alkaline extract of seaweed. The relationship between seaweed and the product of kelp is 20 tons to 1 ton. It's an incredibly laborious process taking place during the summer months in many of the islands and the northwest coastlands. But also distilling, also fishing, and above all, particularly from the American War right down to the end of the Napoleonic Wars, the creation of croft holdings for soldiers who were being encouraged to join the regiments of the clan chiefs during the two great wars, the American War of Independence and the Napoleonic War. Because in one of my books I argue that these elites harvested men in the same way as they harvested the land of their estates. And it was just remembering one extraordinary document in the Lord Macdonald papers in Armadale Castle, headed Lands Given in Return for Sons. In other words, carving out land from the particular estate and allocating it to the family as long as the son or sons joined the colours, or sometimes even preparing land, agreeing that land would be available on the return from the wars. So the first phase of clearance can arguably be regarded as the beginnings of the crofting system. The lotting of land from the old Baltoon, the multiple tenancies which existed in Highland Scotland before the 1750s and 1760s, into the new individual crofts, which were, in an almost a forensic and meticulous way, limited, reduced, in order to force people to indulge in, and families to indulge in, these non-agricultural employments. The great agronomist of the period, Sir John Sinclair, took the view that only two-fifths of subsistence could come from the croft. The rest had to come from the by-employments, which were booming in the late 18th and early 19th centuries, such as kelping, fishing, distilling, military employment, and temporary migration to the harvests of the south. And then the second phase is probably that which is most remembered in the lore and in the sense, the deep sense of the betrayal of the Gael. And that is between about the 1815 period, the end of the Napoleonic Wars, and the great famines of the late 1840s, early 1850s. The heart of that process is the annihilation, the destruction, the implosion of the by-employments. Kelp starts to suffer first as foreign competition kicks in. Fishing is stagnant in the 1810s and 1820s. Illicit whisky making is crushed by the state. Temporary migration is under pressure because of the immigration of Irish competition in the agricultural fields of the lowlands. And at the same time, inexorably, the population continues to rise as the potato and the access to land given through the crofting system and the rampant subdivision of land into tiny particles of territory anchors population, and actually, ironically enough, even in times of crisis and difficulty, limits immigration. And that is the period when clearance moves from relocation, from movement of people in order to extract profit from their activities and their labour, it moves to the classic forms of expulsion. One of the best ways to trace it, ladies and gentlemen, is in the sheriff court records of the Highland towns such as Stornoway, Tobermory, Oban, Lochboisdale. And you see, if you study you look at the summons of removal, that's the actual legal document compelling a family to remove a Whitson, including the servants, cottars, children. Whitson is regarded, because of the spring, as slightly more benevolent than clearing in the autumn months. And although about 90% of the stuff in the boxes that I've looked at in the National Register of Scotland are about debts and nothing at all to do with these things, the highly labour-intensive exercise encountered by that kind of work demonstrates a hugely rising curve in what I would call the index of coercion. The index of coercion. And we're beginning to see in the 1820s, 1830s, what is called compulsory emigration. That is, the people being provided with the bleak choice between removal or removal plus support, usually at least in the 1820s and 1830s, for assisted emigration to Canada. And then comes the Phytophthora infestans in 1846. The disease that had killed the Irish potato crosses the sea. And between 1846-7 and 1855, longer than the Irish crisis, the potato fails in Holland Park, which had been the cornerstone of much of crofting life, especially in the poorer parts of the Highlands. Because you see, the thing is this, the potato is, in that period, the only single crop which can provide all the necessities of life, even including areas where cultivation seems almost impossible. We have a tremendous advantage, as I was saying to a few people earlier, in having a house in the Ross of Mull, in the Isle of Mull, quite close to the ferry crossing for Iona at Finnifort. And around our house, in there, you can see the remains of the Fenachan, the lazy beds, so-called, the cultivation beds, some of them actually raised on bare rock, seaweed brought up, air from other places. And it gives you, especially in the winter when the bracken is down, a sense of the population pressure which existed in some of these areas in that particular period. The actual scraping for existence makes you think of the great phrase in English, I'm translating of course, the great phrase of the French historian of the Bouvet and the Bouvaisie. No peasant willingly gives up his land, be it only half a furrow. No peasant willingly gives up his land, be it only half a furrow. One of the cornerstones of that kind of almost cultural system was the potato, and it fails. And the result is, for the first period, landlord assistance, benevolence, philanthropy from the south, saves the Highland population. There is no Irish catastrophe in Highland Scotland. Nothing like the greatest catastrophe in Western Europe, human catastrophe in Western Europe, in the 19th century, which of course is the catastrophe of the Great Irish Famine, with 1.2 million deaths and 1.3 million emigrants. It still seems almost imaginable that this took place in the richest society, that is the United Kingdom, in the world in the 1840s and 1850s. But what did happen in Highland Scotland was mass emigration. If you compare the period from the census of 1841 to the census of 1861, a third of the population of Gaeldom had left, normally by emigration. 17,000, we know this for certain by the building up of the data, 17,000 alone had been embarked with landlord assistance. 2,300 left from the single estate of Sir James Matheson in Lewes over the period, and similar numbers from the estates of the Dukes of Argyll and Sutherland at that time, and a number of smaller landowners. And although you could argue that in this period many of the people were lusting to go, and where they went was essentially Canada, particularly on Northern Ontario and Australia. Although they were lusting to go, many of them had also to be forced to go. So the rather lugubriously named Sir Edward Pine Coffin, who had spent, of course, you know the family, do you? Of the ancient Cornish family of Pine Coffin. Sir Edward Pine Coffin, who had served in Ireland and in India during famine crises, was astounded by the sheer intensity of clearance, coupled with the retraction of famine relief, the refusal to allow remaining kilt manufacture to occur, and the threatened sequestration of cattle stocks in order to push the people out. Because of what was regarded as the terror of the poor rates, if this redundant population was allowed to stay, landlordism itself would be vanquished because of the amount that would have to be paid out in supporting this population and preventing death through mass destitution. And in the book that all of you, of course, will buy later, because, as I said to people at the last lecture, I've got a large number of needy grandchildren who need considerable support in these straitened times in the UK. The process of elimination of the people, the resulting empty glens, the resulting, you know, especially in the outer islands, the place is littered quite specifically with the partial remains of Baltoon and Crofting townships. But that is only a partial insight to what was going on, because so much of the stone was used in the construction of sheep fanks and of walls for the new great sheep Lantifundia and the medium-sized farms. I can stand behind my house in Mull in the hill and look across and see no less than 5 or 6 ruined townships from the famine period, which were cleared out by the Factor Mór, that's in Gaelic, the big factor, John Campbell of Ardmore from Isla, and his sub-factor known as Big Angus during this particular period. Knocknafinig, Sheerba, Killiwakewin, Spur. But the parish in which the house is had 961 people at the census of 1841. There are now only 2 permanent residents left. Pine Coffin referred to this as the systematic destruction of the pillars of society. So great and so extensive and so intensive was the process of removal. But it ends by the mid-1850s. So that, in a sense, is the broad background, and a very sketchy background, to the process, the cataclysmic process of socio-economic change in the islands. What I want to say now is that it's a dramatic story. It's a story which appeals in song and story. It's the destruction not simply of a population or the removal of a population, but it's also arguably and has been seen as the destruction of a culture. Now, but the vital point is in relation to this audience is that that process of disintegration of a society between the 1750s and the 1850s had precious little direct impact on New Zealand. For 2 reasons. I mean impact in terms of direct emigration to New Zealand. Clearly people who had gone to Australia may have remigrated and come to this country in the late 1850s, 1860s, 1870s. But in terms of direct mass migration, there is very little link between Highland clearances and emigration to New Zealand. One, because mass clearance was over by the mid-1850s. Two, even individual weeding out of people, which still went on after the 1860s, came to an end with the Crofters Holding Act of the 1880s, which gave a new security of tenure to the crofting population. And the other thing which is quite important, even more important, if you look at this, your handout, you see the eloquent statistical evidence. Some people think statistics are arid. In my view, if they are used properly, cogently and selectively, they can be even more eloquent than the printed word. I don't know whether MD agrees with that here. Some of my reviewers certainly don't. Anyway, look at it. Highlands, just over 13%. So, this is the reason, ladies and gentlemen, or one of the main reasons why I decided to open up for you an area of research which is quite literally still in the process of coming out of the research oven. That is the nature of social change and particularly coercive movement in the rural lowlands of Scotland. And by that I mean the eastern coastal strip, the central lowlands of Scotland, as you can see on the map, and the Scottish borders. That's my study area. Because if you look also at those data, if you look at the data in the coloured map, you will see that overwhelmingly the population, the Scottish population of New Zealand, came from that part of Scotia in the second half, particularly in the post-1870 period, down to the period when my analysis will end, which is the Great War of 1914-1918. Now, it is the case that a substantial proportion of those who came to this country from the Scottish lowlands came from the towns and cities. But I think, and I'll try to persuade you of this first of all, the locus of the study must be the rural lowlands, not the cities. Because although there was substantial emigration from Aberdeen, Dundee, Glasgow, Edinburgh, and some of the smaller industrial towns to this country, a very large proportion of that urban population were themselves first or second generation migrants from the Scottish countryside. Let's take the quadrant, let's take the average or the mean of the population of the two biggest cities in Scotland, Edinburgh and Glasgow. The mean is that 56% of that population in 1871, that's Glasgow and Edinburgh combined, were born in either small town village Scotland or in Scottish farms in the central lowlands, the eastern lowlands or the Scottish borders. So even if you can suggest to me that your concentration, your focus on the Scottish countryside is mistaken because of this urban dimension, we should not neglect the relationship and the tension and the dynamic between the rural experience, the urban experience, and then the movement overseas. But even given that, a very significant number, and as you can see from the data on the map again, a very significant number of those Scots who came to this country came from the Scottish countryside, south, east and west of the Highland line. And what I'm saying to you is, by the Scottish countryside I mean obviously the farms, but I also mean the very small towns, and I certainly mean the villages, because the villages will come up later in my presentation as extremely important. So what I want to do now is, I want to do three things for the remainder of the presentation. The first is, I want to convince you that the word clearance can actually be applied to the set of social changes which alter the traditional pattern of life in rural and lowland Scotland forever. And by clearance, again to remind you, I mean enforced movement, either indirect, direct, subtle coercion, even coercion by what I would call stealth, which doesn't immediately build the same picture as the factor visiting the cottage in Western Ross and telling the people to go. There are other means of expelling people from land than that particularly drastic, brutal and dramatic methodology. And then I want to go on secondly to suggesting ways in which these lowland clearances, maybe not impelled and ensured that people would come from Scotland to this country, but helped to certainly encourage it and facilitate it. And finally, I want to indulge in what you would call personal indulgence, because the most fascinating aspect to me is, why is it that the Highland clearances are remembered in song and story? Why is it that the Highland clearances preserve a sense in Scottish culture of gross and massive dispossession of people? But the phrase the Lowland clearances is an historian's construct. It doesn't have any further reverberation in cultural terms. Why is that? Why was there no sense building up in Lowland Scotland of a lost way of life, as there undoubtedly was, and I can assure you, still is, in some parts of Gaeldom? To begin with, therefore, the process of what I've identified as clearance in the Scottish Lowlands. Very quickly, to start with, the base of the population round about the 1740s and 1750s, in order to allow you to understand how that social structure was changed. Okay, in a very simple sense it was this. Scotland had the highest concentration of land ownership of any country in Western or Central Europe. Less than 0.3% of the population owned land, about 7,000 landowners. But even that gives a false impression, because the great landowners, the dukes, the earls and the lords, probably about 100 families owned most of Scotland, as, very interestingly, they still do to this day. The Scottish landed class were never put through what F.M.L. Thompson called the mincing machine of land reform in Ireland in the late 19th, early 20th centuries. Below that, since ownership was so concentrated, those who worked the land were tenant farmers. They varied in great significance and number and size. Many of them were multiple tenants, working land communally, but there was also single tenants at the time. Below them, and this is a vitally important class to understand Lowland clearance, the cottars. If any of you are from Scotland, there's a very good chance that you can trace your ancestry back to the pre-improvement cottage class in the rural counties of Lowland Scotland. The poll tax of the 1690s, so the three poll taxes of the 1690s, are a serious source for understanding social structure. Because unlike the Thatcher poll taxes of the 1980s in the UK, the 1690s poll tax was based on ability to pay. So it's possible to see the number of, you get in terms of the tax lists, almost a social structural profile of a particular parish. And when you look at that, you find that a third to a half of all families were cottars. And therefore, to define the term cotter, some of them are tradesmen, carpenters, shoemakers, blacksmiths, weavers, who have a small plot of land, usually not more than 2 or 3 acres, as a source of subsistence. But the vast majority of the cottar families are given land by tenant farmers in return for providing labour at those two huge peaks of the year, the peat cutting for fuel and the harvest, the grain and drink harvest, the food and drink harvest of August and September. And then below that group, you've got a smaller element. Married farm servants who are engaged for a year, single farm servants, male and female, who are engaged for 6 months. Most of this group we now know came from the cotter class, and many of them returned to the cotters at the age of marriage when they were able to carve out a small area of potato land, of garden land, from the father's patch. What is the uniformity that binds that society, ladies and gentlemen? It is that virtually everybody in the countryside has direct access to land. Right, that's very important in terms of what's to happen. It might be minuscule, that is the access, but it's there. And even those landless elements, like farm servants, married or unmarried, and particularly the young unmarrieds, coming from the ranks of those with a small, limited access to land and possibly returning to that landed status, however small and however minuscule, at marriage or later. Two major things rend this social system apart. The first is markets. I think, as explained in my last lecture, Scotland had the fastest rate of urbanisation of any country in Western Central Europe between the 1750s and the 1830s. Those townspeople had to be fed. There had to be horses to carry transportation. There had to be wood for building. So the market for agricultural produce literally went through the roof. And the second thing was ideology. The ideology of the late 18th, early 19th century had it, rightly or wrongly, that communal agriculture, the sharing of farm work, the pooling of capital assets, the pooling of labour assets was wrong. It infringed and limited enterprise. There had to be individualism. And the individuals on the land meant the consolidation of tenancies under one master and the development of that. And there's a range of things. In Ayrshire, the dairy farming district consolidation was quite limited. In the great sheep, in the great corn factories of the Lothians, it was massive. 600, 700, 800 acre grain farms in that area. And there was diversity everywhere else. But the main thing is that between 1750 and 1830, the number of direct tenants fell massively. In a study I did in the 1990s, which is published in a book called The Transformation of Rural Scotland, in a sample of 18 landed estates, looking at rentals, and the only way this could be done was with three research assistants, so labour intensive was the process of investigation. Between 1730 and 1820, in this sample, the average fall in tenant numbers was 86%. So there's a catastrophic decline in the tenants who would have held land if they had been part of the old system. But the most amazing thing of all, ladies and gentlemen, is the elimination of a class. There are no cotters left. There are no cotters left in Lowland Scotland by 1830. There are crofters and farmers in Highland Scotland, despite the horrors of what was going on up there. But there are no cotters remaining in a region of Scotland where they had been in such a substantial minority in the old world, in the old society. And we know from the first statistical account, which was published in the 1790s, the constant refrain by parish ministers' reporters of the mouldering remains of the houses of the old cottage. It's identical to what was said about the clearances in Sutherland, in Wester Ross, and in Skye in the 1840s. Excuse me, in the 1840s and 1850s. And what I'm saying to you is this. At the end of the lease, tenant farmers who had traditionally perhaps held land, and the leases were now between 9 and 18 years, at the end of that lease, they could be forced to move. It's not clearance in the sense of being booted out through a summons of removal, but it's certainly removal which is based on law. They have to go. Then the cotters, who have no right to land legally, are removed, are eliminated over two generations. If you want to consider the heart of the Lowland clearances, it's the disappearance of an entire social tier, which was important in the old countryside, in the old pre-improvement social system. And then the third manifestation of clearance in this world, and the earliest, which has, I think, some implications for this country, New Zealand, is the great development in the period from about the mid-17th century through to the mid-18th century of large-scale cattle ranching in the southern uplands of Scotland, that is the eastern and western districts, and large-scale sheep ranching in the central and eastern districts, and large-scale sheep ranching in the western districts. The creation of vast parklands, formerly occupied by many tenant farmers and cotters, the old townships or toons, farm toons as they're called, is simply swept away. We know that this is going on because the only major protest during the Lowland clearances occurred in Galloway in 1724, the so-called Levellers' Revolt, when the dikes that were being raised to establish these large latifundia, when these dikes were being raised, were put down literally by thousands of armed men, and 16 troops of dragoons had to be called out to deal with them. And of course, it's got implications for this country, because that's the area where the great sheep breeds, which were taken to New Zealand in the last half of the 19th century. And as I saw the other day up in Queenstown, that's also the source of the dogs, the sheep dogs, who became so important. And of that, probably as important as the Scottish engineer, the Scottish gardener, the Scottish physician or doctor, and the Scottish professor and the Scottish minister, namely the Scottish shepherd. Because the evolution of those breeds in southern upland Scotland then travelled north during the Highland clearances, the Cheviot and the Blackface, and then were re-exported to what used to be called the colonies. So that's the first part. The second issue is, what is the relationship of this social transformation to Scottish emigration to New Zealand? Well, first of all, obviously, it has relevance to Scottish emigration globally, not specifically to New Zealand. But it does have a particular resonance here, in one sense, or at least a resonance here in a kind of paradoxical sense. Because if you follow my analysis, ladies and gentlemen, the Lowland clearances are over by the 1850s, 1860s. So you can hardly say that the old cotter class decided to leave Scotland for a life abroad. It wasn't simple like that. That is not the way the lubrication to emigration took place. What happened was this. By the 1850s, the overwhelming majority of the countryside population of Scotland were landless and had to sell their labour power in the market in order to survive. If you were a married farm servant, you had a fee for a year. If you were a single male farm servant, for 6 months. If such a fee was not available, you were not simply unemployed, you were without accommodation. And the Scottish poor law, in terms of welfare support, was notoriously harsh. So you could, because of this, there's an extraordinary level of internal mobility among the unmarried and the married ploughman class in Lowland Scotland. One of the very arresting reports in the Royal Commissions is, since the farmer, you know, who was maybe hiring somebody from a distance to take the role of the person who had been sacked or had moved on, they would send carts for the belongings, etc. And of course the accommodation, albeit very limited, in the bothy or the cottage was there. But time after time come across reports of the doors of the cottages, with dozens of new keyholes. A reflection of the constant turnover of ploughmen in this society. And therefore one connection with emigration is, if they were mobile at home, it was much, much easier to be mobile abroad, especially with the steamship, the telegraph, and the fact that we're dealing with a highly literate population in this period. The second connection with emigration is land. The evidential reports in the various commissions, you know, trying to get a sense of history from below, which are available, indicate that a major desire of these individuals, and remember, they are highly skilled. The Scottish horseman, the Scottish ploughman, is a skilled man. He is, in a sense, a professional of his trade, an aristocrat of labour, only gained after years of training from halfling right through to full horseman. And the realisation, both of that particular group and of the tenant farmers who are only leasing land, is that they will never enjoy full independency. They will never enjoy upward social mobility unless they get out of Scotland. Because only by leaving Scotland will they achieve access to land and even achieve access to large areas of land, which in terms of the social memory, the folk memory of the people, their ancestors had in times past. And land is the great magnet, especially for the rural population. And the Joe Duncan, who was secretary of the Scottish Farm Servants Union just before the First World War, came up or put a very interesting additional point into this analysis. Because single farm servants, single men and women, were not paid until the end of their six-month term in cash, they were paid in kind, of course, to keep themselves alive, it was a form of forced saving. And they used these forced savings to take ship for Canada, for the USA, and particularly if they were agricultural people, Canada, New Zealand, and even, dare I mention it, Australia. So for that element, for that mass of the rural population, especially with rising expectations in the late 19th century, the impact of the 1872 Education Act, the rising wages, the availability of newspapers, the notion through the railway penetration, the transportation penetration to the countryside, the vital importance of the bicycle, the people visiting towns and villages and seeing, you know, a different form of life. Between 1840 and 1914, a third of Scottish ploughmen left their employment, either for the towns, the cities, or for overseas. And the final link with emigration, I would argue, is to do with the big farmer class. These individuals, many of whom started to populate settlement colonies such as New Zealand, Australia and Canada, had a tremendous advantage over other potential colonisers. They had access to the funding reserves of the Scottish investment trusts. You see, Scotland, as the first industrial nation, had built up vast sums of capital. The Scottish internal market was limited, both in terms of number and in terms of the relatively low wage earning capacities of the industrial workers. So what happens in the late 19th and early 20th century, ladies and gentlemen, the fruits of Scottish industrialism in terms of treasure go overseas. They go overseas. And I remember Neil Asherson, the distinguished journalist who reviewed this book in the London Review of Books, said the title of the review was "It Is Still There," meaning the treasure. It may be still there in the railways, in the farms of New Zealand, in the vineyards up there, and the railway stations, but it's not in Scotia, and it's not owned by Scottish hands. And I just want one speculates, would Scotland's 20th century crisis have occurred if at least some of that capital, which is impossible to have happened, of course, in a private enterprise economy, if some of that capital could have been retained to rebuild the nation's decaying industrial structure from the 1920s onwards. Okay, for the last 5 minutes or so, why is it that if you accept that in terms of scale, removal is by no means limited to Gaeldom? But what is limited to Gaeldom is the folk sense of dispossession, the mark on the, if you like, the collective psychology of the population, and the resonance that a phrase like the Highland Clearances has in Scottish culture and among even contemporary Scots, in a way which the concept I have described does not. This is now going into the area of speculation, but historians must speculate, because that's the foundation then of the systematic foundational research which will follow. So these are ideas rather than, in any sense, proven arguments. I think you could argue the first essential is to note the cultural difference between the two societies. Not the economic difference, but the cultural difference. The concept of Durchus, the almost untranslatable Gaelic word, untranslatable in the sense it's got a number of translations, but essentially has the idea that the chief and leading gentry in the clanship-based society have the privilege of being leaders and have the privilege of exacting rent and taking people out to war and armed conflict, but they also have the duty of protectors. And that is a fundamental part of the ethos of clanship, right from the development of the great clans and the sects of the great clans in the 12th, 13th century. And because the military society in the Highlands lasts longer than the Lowlands, that ethic is still there. I've come across it even in evidence to the Napier Commission in the 1880s, long after, you know, clearance is supposed to have destroyed the bond between elites and people. Now, what caused an even bigger problem, arguably, was clanship did not die at Culloden. Historian says clanship did not die at Culloden. He was arrested and taken away to the local lunatic asylum. And I understand from Professor McCarthy that they don't exist anymore. Put in care then. The thing was that there was the development of what you would call neo-clanship. That is the creation of these family regiments during the Seven Years' War, the American War of Independence, and the Napoleonic Wars. It was the most militarized society in Europe by 1800, in terms of volunteers, in terms of soldiers of the line, and in terms of those people who joined the Royal Navy. And as I indicated earlier, often the means of attracting young men to the colours, because they didn't want to join necessarily, was the promise of land. And the great breach that occurred in the 1810s and 1820s, even for solid, coherent and understandable economic reasons, that you could argue the Highland population growth was unsustainable, or for whatever reason, those promises, which were literally paid in blood, were betrayed. And that caused angst. Whereas in Lowland Scotland, the relationship between landowner, tenant farmer, married servant, single servant and day labourer was exclusively economic. It was accepted in that world. They did not expect their employer to take care of them for life. They did not expect the paternalism which was at the very heart of Durchus in the Gaelic situation. I think the second reason why the outcomes in terms of social memory were so different, and this is the last thing I'll say, although I could go on for a long time, but it's becoming boring. The second thing was that, you see, the type of agriculture in the Highlands after the by-employments had disintegrated, the cattle agriculture, the sheep farming industry, It was highly land and capital intensive. The ratio was one shepherd to 600 sheep. It had no need for population engagement. It had no requirement to employ large numbers of people. They were by definition now redundant. The economy, the pastoral economy, was highly profitable. But it was not an economic system which absorbed the population. They had to go. Whereas outside echelons or parts of the Scottish borders, Scottish farming in the lowland countryside was mixed farming. And to create that new capitalist agriculture between 1760 and 1820, at the time when the lowland clearances are at their height, there was massive demand for labour. You just have to reflect, those of you who have visited the Scottish countryside, the lowland Scottish countryside, you know, basically a large bog before 1750. Again, Asherson's words, Scottish land, even in the most fertile parts, is but skin over bone. So there was no natural endowment which would have allowed the agriculture to flourish as it did do in the 19th century. Instead, it was human intervention and masses of it. The building of the infrastructure, the estate roads, the big houses, the farmsteadings, the enclosures. Again, as I indicated in the last lecture, by 1840, the kind of landscape you see now in rural lowland Scotland was there. It hardly changed at all except for motor cars and electricity pylons. And that required a huge injection of labour at a time when many men were fighting abroad anyway in the wars, at a time when others were being drawn to the towns because this was the Industrial Revolution. So one big difference between the two societies was in the lowlands, lowland clearance took place in a context of vast labour-intensive activity in Western Highland and insular Scotland. Clearance took place in a society which had no need for such vast amounts of labour input. So the economic dynamic favoured acceptance in the south and favoured alienation in the north. Thank you.
Professor Devine, for that stimulating talk, and particularly doing it with that very bad cold that you're suffering at the moment. we do have a little bit of time for questions, if anyone...
One thing that struck me, Professor, was you mentioned in passing the dreadful... the harsh poor laws in Scotland, and I couldn't help thinking of the contrast with the drive towards universal education in Scotland, generations ahead of what was achieved in England. And I see these as two sides to a sense of social justice. How is it that the Scots were so lacking in one thing and so to the fore with the other?
The difference is perhaps more apparent than real. Maybe expand it. The difference is to some extent more apparent than real because remember, education was not free. It had to be paid for. So there was an assumption that people had responsibility. This was a key aspect of the educational system. And because it was such a key aspect and people had to pay no matter the limited amounts, it became over time regarded as simply unrespectable not to guide your children at least to some level of basic literacy. It became a social given that you would do this. It was part of almost your acceptance within the parish society. And the reason why I suggest that the poor law system is not all that different is because that was also intended to avoid dependency. That was also intended to ensure that people, that individuals, would not, unlike what they thought they saw as the malevolent effect of the more generous system in England, that it would be very much seen as a last resort. I mean, it was a terrifying system in that sense, but of course, by the standards of what you might call the more positive development of education. But in a sense, what you could say is that both helped to produce, in combination, that very intangible thing, but certainly contemporary commentators took the view that it existed, the distinctive Scottish work ethic.
Could you
question?
Obviously, I'm not a social engineer, so it's very difficult to answer that. But you're absolutely right in one sense. There's a continued perpetuation of injustice. I mean, one of the saddest chapters in the book that I had to write was the Scottish treatment, of Scottish settlers. Not I don't think I make any reference to New Zealand in this chapter. So I suppose that's not a bad thing in the present context, but it's called Scottish Settlers and Native Peoples, and I look at Ulster Scots in the backlands of the American colonies and in the USA. I look at the role of Scots from Orkney in particular in the Hudson's Bay Company, and I look at the role of Scottish settlers in Australia. And one of the saddest aspects of that analysis, much of which is very sad and tragic, is cleared Gaels from Invernessia in particular in the 1840s and 1850s, revisiting what was done to them and Aboriginal peoples when some of them settled in parts of Australia. You know, it's a horrible, almost recycling of what went on. As to how to deal with it, I think the only two techniques modern cultures and civilizations have are education and law.
Your mention of Joe Duncan and a little later of the Scottish work ethic reminded me of a story I was told by a politician whom I knew well, the late Fred Martin in Aberdeenshire.
Right.
And Joe Duncan said to him one day, Doonsooth, it's just ploughing, it's just another job. Up here, it's a profession.
That's it. That's exactly it. If you look, I mean, again in the book, what I say is that clearly in relation to other societies, other countries, rather, in the 19th century or the 20th century, there's a higher percentage of people being educated in a university way in Scotland than probably anywhere else in Europe. But even then, it was a very small proportion. I mean, even when I went to university, only 4% of the cohort went to university. And that wasn't in the 19th century. So the argument in the book is that we underestimate the great universities of Scotland, the shipyards of the Clyde, and the farm steadings of the Mearns. I mean, I ran a research institute at Aberdeen University between 1998 and 2005. And because I had a research professorship, I didn't have to be there all the time, and so, you know, up and down quite a bit. And, you know, it's the word that comes to mind again that I implied earlier on, the sheer gardenly care, the fields, which were the result of the mark on the land left by generations of highly skilled and hardworking people. Yeah, it's a testament to their